over here.
Stay over there.
Stay with Auntie Mel.
I gotta come all the way over here. Give me a hug.
Good.
I'm so glad you're here. And the whole crew. Awesome.
Spoiled. No, not at all.
She's still eating those little milk bones you gave her. Pug life, yeah. Good morning. Let me move this up here. How's that? Better? Yeah, good. We're all very excited. I heard people this morning saying it's good to see you, and I heard people saying it's good to be seen. We are glad to be here this morning because this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Please bow your heads for the invocation. Oh God, our ruler and shepherd, you anointed Jesus as the king and servant of your people. Make us attentive to your word this morning that we may accept your reign over us and serve you and you alone. Amen. If you're able, please stand and join in the responsive call to worship as printed in your bulletin. Blessed are those who trust in the Lord.
They shall be like a tree planted by the water, sending out its roots by the stream.
Baptized and freed, grounded in love, let us worship God. Christ is risen. Alleluia. Please join me in the responsive prayer of confession. Holy God, we confess that we have strayed from your paths of right relationship and peace, and we have dishonored you, ourselves, and creation. We repent of these hurtful ways. Forgive us, we pray, as we learn to forgive others and guide our feet into the way of the Lord. Amen.
Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. You may be seated. And get comfortable because I got a ton of announcements and prayer requests. First of all, birthdays. Kathleen McNeil Wedge, Andrew Bidlin, Bill Gilbert, and Kyan Linton all have birthdays. I'd like to say, she's not going to be happy that I'm drawing everyone's attention to her, but I would like you all to know that Rhonda Cruzy is with us this morning. She is the transitional leader of Lehigh Presbytery. So we are... I see her smiling face all the time, but I'm glad she's here to help us in our worship this morning. And of course, everybody's very excited Amy Hartman Pigeon and her family are here this morning. So we're happy to see you. And Donna Pontician is back with us. So grateful for healing mercies for her, and we will continue to hold your husband in prayer as he is struggling to make the comeback. We are having communion today. Connie and I somehow missed getting that in the bulletin, but we will be having communion. It is the first Sunday of the month, so just plan that in your head. We are still looking for volunteers who would be willing to cook a meal when we have people in our numbers who are recovering from illness or injury. If you can help with that, please let Megan know. Her email address is in your bulletin. Again, we are meeting back inside the church on Sunday, June 20th. That is Father's Day. We will also be welcoming some new members into our numbers. And don't forget to bring your masks. We will be still socially distancing, but it will be good to be back inside and be together. Last announcement I have is that our men's fellowship group had their first outing yesterday, and it was a rousing success. We did some hot glass work, and I emphasize the hot glass work, yesterday at the Banana Factory, and they opened it to the ladies as well, so we had five men and five ladies, and it was really a lot of fun. In fact, for some of you are not on Facebook, so Guy made a handy-dandy poster, and you can come and see it afterward of everyone doing the stop. Anyway, so if you'd like to look at this, I'll put it over here on the bench. Sorry about Luna, you guys. She doesn't like me doing stuff that she's not involved in. I know. So I'll just put this over here if you would like to see that. The next men's fellowship event is July 10th. They will be going over here in Copley to Lehigh Valley Sporting Clays and doing skeet shooting. So if you are interested in joining that, please either you can reach out to Connie in the office, or you could speak directly to Guy. And that is that open to the ladies as well? Or
it is.
Open to the ladies as well. Yeah, awesome. Prayer requests. Pat Frankenfield has asked that we remember her cousin, William Coons. He lives in Florida. He is dealing with some serious illnesses. Again, Deb Bartholomew's brother, Dan Reed, we keep him in our prayers. Tom and Sally have asked that we pray for their granddaughter, Amy. She is traveling to Seattle, driving out there, leaving this week for a work thing. She is just, her and her dog, Maisie, are making this cross-country trip together, so please keep Amy in your prayers. Barb Quigg has asked that we remember her cousin, Jane Pereira, who has had three more seizures and is back in Good Shepherd, so please keep Jane and her husband in your prayers as well. And finally, I got a note this week from Barry Keck. He said that Janet had some sort of an accident. He didn't specify, and she broke her leg and her ankle bone in two places. And she has had surgery, and she is home repairing, getting her bones knit back together. So please keep them in your prayers. Barry reports that he has been watching a lot of YouTube videos to improve his cooking skills. So you may want to reach out to them and see if they need food. So please keep Janet and Barry in your prayers as well. Anything else that I need to add to the prayer list this morning?
Well, Carol Clancy.
Oh, sorry. Yes, I knew there was something I was forgetting. Carol Clancy was in the hospital for some tests over the week, yesterday, I guess, Friday?
She was in Thursday night into Friday.
Thursday night into Friday. She was in for some tests, but she's home now.
I talked to her yesterday, and she's feeling much better.
Okay, she is feeling better. So please keep Carol Clancy in your prayers as well. Yes.
She's doing a girl on our prayer list, Caroline Lawthorne.
Yes.
She's 21 years old and has had cancer four times. She's doing an experimental treatment at CHOP. It's called HUCART, HUCART, and it starts tomorrow.
Okay.
So if we could give some extra prayers to her.
Right. Okay.
Yes,
I don't know if you could hear Sue. Her daughter has a friend, Caroline Loghorn.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, and she is going through cancer for the fourth time. You said
leukemia.
Leukemia for the fourth time. She's had a recurrence, and she is currently being treated at CHOP and starts a new experimental treatment tomorrow. So, please keep her in your family and her family in your prayers as well. Anything else? Okay. Let us pray. Creator God, you call us to love and serve you with body and mind and spirit through loving your creation and our sisters and brothers as ourselves. Open our hearts in compassion and receive these petitions on behalf of the needs of the church and the world. We lift to you this morning those who are in need, those who are suffering from physical illness, emotional turmoil, economic hardship, loneliness, anxiety, isolation. We pray this morning for your healing mercies on Caroline, on Carol, on William, on Dan, and on Janet, and on Jane. And we pray, Lord, for those who are caring for them. Grant them peace and rest and the nearness and the comfort of your presence. And we're grateful for your healing touch on Dan and Tim, on Donna, and on Marie Lychak. God, we pray this morning for those in our world who are hurting after senseless acts of violence. Even while we pray for their comfort, we pray you will open our eyes to how we can help, how we can reach out, how we can share the mercy and peace of Jesus, who loved justice and showed love and mercy to all. And finally, O Holy One, hear our prayers and make us faithful stewards of the fragile bounty of this earth so that we may be entrusted with the riches of heaven. We pray all these things in the sacred name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, we don't have any kids today, no little ones. You guys don't want to come up for a children's chat, do you? No, it's not so much. Okay. Okay. Okay, then Sally will come up and lead us in our readings. It says it's on.
Now it's on.
Yeah, you're
now.
Good. You're good.
Please join me for the prayer of illumination, bowing your heads. God, our helper, by your Holy Spirit, open our minds that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may be led into your truth and taught your will for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. First reading this morning is the Old Testament, 1 Samuel 8. 4 to 11. So all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah. They said to him, "You are old, and your sons do not walk in your ways. Now appoint a king to lead us, such as all the other nations have." But when they said, "Give us a king to lead us," this displeased Samuel. So he prayed to the Lord. And the Lord told him, "Listen to all that the people are saying to you. It is not you they have rejected, but they have rejected me as their king. As they have done from day I brought them up out of Egypt until this day, forsaking me and serving other gods, so they are doing to you. Now listen to them, but warn them solemnly and let them know what the king who will reign over them will do." Samuel told all the words of the Lord to the people who were asking him for a king. He said, "This is what the king who will reign over you will do. He will take your sons and make them serve with his chariots and horses, and they will run in front of his chariots." The second reading today is from the New Testament, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, 13 to chapter 5, 1. "It is written, 'I believe, therefore I have spoken.' With that same spirit of faith, we also believe and therefore speak, Because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead will also raise us with Jesus and present us with you in his presence. All this is for your benefit, so that the grace that is reaching more and more people may cause thanksgiving to overflow to the glory of God. Therefore, we do not lose heart, though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and our moment troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Now we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands.
And our gospel reading this morning is from the book of Mark, chapter 3, verses 20 through 35. Jesus entered a house, and the crowd gathered again so that they were not even able to eat. When his family heard this, they set out to restrain him, because they said, "He's out of his mind." The scribes who had come down from Jerusalem said, "He is possessed by Beelzebub, and he drives out demons by the ruler of the demons." So he summoned them and spoke to them in parables. How can Satan drive out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan opposes himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but is finished. But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his possessions unless first he ties up the strong man. Then he can plunder his house. Truly I tell you, people will be forgiven for all sins and whatever blasphemies they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin, because they were saying, "He has an unclean spirit." His mothers and brothers came, standing outside. They sent word to him and called him. A crowd was sitting around him and told him, "Look, your mother, your brothers, and your sisters are outside asking for you." He replied to them, "Who are my mother and my brothers?" Looking at those sitting in a circle around him, he said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother." The word of the Lord. One of the things that people tell me is really troubling them right now is the fact that our nation is so fractured, politically, racially, socially, you name it. Because it seems like everywhere we look, there are lines drawn in the sand, us versus them. And of course, the hardest part for most of us are when those lines are drawn in our friends groups, in our churches, and maybe especially in our homes. These kinds of divides, no matter what side of the line you're on, are really hard to deal with. And right now, so many of us are feeling like these are unprecedented, horrible times, worse times than the world has ever known. So I'm sure it's cold comfort to hear today's reading from Mark's Gospel and realize that these are not unprecedented times. Social and political and religious divides have plagued the world throughout history. But the most destructive divides, and the ones that often lead to the bigger divides, are the ones that we create in our own lives, in our own minds, and in our own hearts. We unintentionally cause our own internal conflict, and that translates into exterior conflicts. And pretty soon everything is a great big mess, and we find ourselves not only in conflict with those around us, but with ourselves. In fact, it's these kinds of divisions that Jesus is facing in today's passage from Mark. From the beginning of Jesus' ministry, according to Mark, he's been dealing with divided houses and divided kingdoms. But to really understand that, in the context of Jesus' ministry, we have to look at the different ways a house can be divided. So let's think about some of the people that we have read about in Mark's gospel in recent weeks. Is that better? Okay. People Jesus has healed and helped. He healed Simon Peter's mother-in-law. He healed a leper. He cast out demons. He made a paralyzed man able to walk again. And in a manner of speaking, these people's houses were divided. Problems have entered their homes. Their lives were not their own. Not only do they live with inner conflict and turmoil, they've been cast out of society. There was a line drawn in the sand there. The outsiders are there. The insiders are here. And for those on the outside, their physical conditions, their illnesses, were what caused their inner turmoil. They've been separated from their community, in some cases from their families. And this creates kind of an identity crisis and a spiritual crisis for them. But even in Jesus' time, these sorts of battles and interior conflicts weren't new. We can trace them all the way back to Adam and Eve, when they ate the fruit and separated themselves from God, and they hid among the trees in the garden. We see it when Israel wanted a king, so it could be like all the other nations, forgetting that Israel wasn't like all the other nations, but had a unique calling as the people of God. And of course, these kinds of divisions and inner conflicts are a reality for us today, both in our world and in our personal lives. We see it every day. A marriage divided ends in divorce. A country divided results in unrest, and in extreme cases, civil war. An economy divided leads to poverty and injustice, and a community divided leads to prejudice and violence. I have a friend, and I'm telling a bit of her story here this morning with her permission. She told me that throughout her 20s, she was terrified of being found out. She was one person at work, she was another person at home, and in her moments alone, she was a third person, that one, a severe alcoholic. She lived in fear that her husband and her boss would find out about her drinking, even though she went to great pains to hide it from everyone. Her outside and her inside didn't match up. She was a house divided. Now, in some ways, I'm sure all of us have felt that way at one time or another. We know what it's like to live divided lives. We act one way with certain people and a different way with other people. And it isn't always done with forethought or bad intentions. Sometimes life just gets divided into pieces. Our behavior, our beliefs, even our ethics become situational. We have our work life, our family life, our prayer life, our personal life, our social life. Pretty soon our whole life is just like a bunch of pieces, like a scattered jigsaw puzzle. If you've ever found yourself feeling as though you're scrambling to collect the pieces of your life and put them back together, if you feel like you're going crazy, and especially if you're feeling that way right now, let's just take a moment here. Let's just pause, okay? Take a deep breath. Blow it out. Okay, one more time. Blow it out. Now hear me when I say this. You're not crazy. Life sometimes just makes us feel that way. And because life can make us feel that way, we're in the perfect position to understand what's going on in today's passage from Mark. Basically, everyone we see in this story is trying to put the pieces of their lives back together. The crowd gathered around Jesus, the religious authorities who were opposing him, his family trying to restrain him and drag him home because they think he's lost his marbles. In their own way, everyone in this story is trying to put the pieces of their life back together, but it isn't working. The pieces don't fit. And they're faced with a difficult reality. Their life and their world isn't what they thought it was. Jesus' arrival in their midst has ripped off the thin covering that hid from the world the very different lives they were leading. Because that's what Jesus does. It's what he did for people in today's story. It's what he did for people throughout the Gospels. It's what he does for us today. Our lives are fractured and fragmented. We present different sides of ourselves in different situations. Without meaning to, probably without even knowing that we're doing it, we divide our lives. We divide our houses. And Jesus tells us that a house, a kingdom divided, cannot stand. So Jesus does for us what we can't do for ourselves. He puts the pieces of our lives back together. He puts our houses back in order. But that's not always easy to accept, is it? Because most of the time, Jesus doesn't put things back the way they were before. And that can be scary. Change can be frightening. We see that loud and clear in the people's reactions in the passage of the gospel scriptures we read this morning. They look at Jesus, they hear what he's saying, they realize that he's going to put their lives back together in ways they aren't used to, and they just go, psh, he's crazy. Even his mother and his brothers think he's lost his grip on sanity. But when the religious leaders accuse Jesus of being in league with Satan, they're really saying more about themselves than they are about Jesus. Therapists call that projecting. They're projecting their own internal conflict, their own divided houses, onto Jesus. Jesus is holy and sacred and filled with the Spirit of God, but they accuse him of being broken and dirty and in cahoots with the devil. They accuse him rather than looking at what's broken in themselves. Here's another example. This is an extreme example. The Apostle Paul, the guy who wrote the majority of the New Testament, started out as a real stinker. When he was Saul of Tarsus, he persecuted Christians, literally dragging them out of their homes and having them thrown into prison. Christians were dying because of Saul. He was the worst. Saul's house was divided. Saul was at war with Christians because Saul was at war with himself. Did Jesus fix him? Oh, yeah, he did. He knocked him on his keister with a blinding light from heaven. And he spoke to him in an audible voice, and he called him out for persecuting him. That was the turning point. Jesus took all the broken pieces of Saul's life and put them back together again in a whole new way. And Saul became Paul, the apostle of Christ, whose writings we still quote today. It's hard to look at what's broken in ourselves. It's hard to face the fact that Jesus sees what's broken in us and wants to change us in order to fix it. On paper, that sounds beautiful. In reality, it's seriously scary. But Jesus gets that. Jesus has known from the beginning that he came to earth to fix us, to make us whole again. If we flip ahead in our Bibles to Luke 4, he says as much. In chapter 16 through verses 16 through 21, it says, Jesus went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom, and he stood up to read. The scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and a recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him, and he began by saying to them, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." Can you imagine that? Jesus going, "That's me he's talking about." It's amazing to read through the Gospels and see how many people Jesus made whole again. He comforted the grieving. He healed the sick. He restored sight to the blind. He put the lame back on their feet. And he literally raised people from the dead. And we sit here and we read those stories, and we go, "Wow, that's amazing. Praise God, that's awesome how Jesus did that." But then we feel those little nudges from the Holy Spirit, that little voice that whispers, "What about you? We don't like that so much." It's a little uncomfortable to think about that. We don't like to think about the pieces of our lives making us not that much different from the people Jesus touched in the first century, but it's true. We are every bit as much in need of his touch to make us whole again. But we can't become whole until we admit that we're broken. Where are our houses divided this morning? How have we created division and conflict in our own lives? What areas of our lives are fractured or broken? Where have our lives been shattered by anger or insecurity or greed or sorrow or envy or guilt? What has divided your house? There are a million and one things that can divide our houses and shatter our lives. But the good news is that Jesus is stronger than any of that. He is stronger than anything that fragments our lives. Jesus binds the forces that divide. He heals the wounds that separate. And he puts the pieces of our broken lives back together in ways that we never dreamed possible, making us whole again. There is nothing about our lives, any of our lives, your life, my life, that cannot be put back together by the love of God through Jesus. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand if you are able and join me in reading the Apostles' Creed. And I just want to point out one more time that this is a little bit different than what we've been reading. It has a line that has been added back into it, so as printed in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He sitteth and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Once again, we are not going to pass the offering plate. I know some of you have put your offering in here. If you have offering and you would like to add it to the plate, please come forward now while we all watch you, Deb. Yeah. Let the mind of Christ lead us to share generously and compassionately, not only in this morning's offering, but in everything we do and say. Amen. Friends, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. They will come from east and west, from north and south, and sit at the table in the kingdom of God. According to Luke, when our risen Lord was at table with his disciples, he took the bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them. Then their eyes were open and they recognized him. This is the Lord's table. Our Savior invites those who trust him to share the feast which he has prepared. The Lord be with you. And also with you. Lift up your hearts. Lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, eternal God, our Creator. You have given us life and second birth in your Spirit. Once we were no people, but now we are your people. You claimed Israel as your chosen nation and raised up the church as a witness to the resurrection, breathing into it your life and power. From worlds apart, you gathered us together. When we go astray, you welcome us home. Always your love has been steadfast. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with the choirs of heaven and with all the faithful of every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your name, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. In love with you and in compassion for all, Jesus healed and taught, challenged and comforted, welcomed and saved. He formed a community, promising to be with his disciples wherever two or three were gathered, and sending them on his mission of hope and healing in the world. Jesus trusted his life to you and went freely to his death so the world might be set free from suffering and sin. You raised him from death and raise us also to live a new life with him. In the power of the Holy Spirit, you send us out to make disciples as he commanded. Remembering all your mighty and merciful acts, we take this bread and this wine from the gifts you have given us and celebrate with joy the redemption won for us in Jesus Christ. Accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, as a living and holy offering of ourselves, that our lives may proclaim the one crucified and risen. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, unite us with the living Christ and with all who are baptized in his name, that we may be one in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. O God, today you have called us together to be the church. Unite us now at your table, and in one loaf and a common cup, make us one in Christ Jesus. Let your Spirit empower the life we share and ignite our witness in the world. With all who have gone before us, keep us faithful to the gospel teachings and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Give us strength to serve you until the promised day of the resurrection, when with the redeemed of all the ages we will feast with you at your table in glory. And now, as Christ our Savior taught us, we pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Body of our Lord Jesus Christ. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and poured from it, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this, do this in remembrance of me." the blood of the Lamb, the cup of salvation. Every time you eat this bread and drink of this cup, you proclaim the saving death of the risen Lord until he comes again. Let us pray. Gracious God, may we who have received the sacrament live in the unity of your Holy Spirit, that we may show forth your gifts to all the world. We ask this in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Let us share that peace from a safe distance with one another. Peace be with you all. And now the benediction. Go forth to follow paths of righteousness. Go forth to follow paths of peace. And may God's goodness and mercy follow you as you serve the risen Lord. Amen.
Yeah.